Hey fellow tennis nerds, I hope all is well. It's okay here, but it's raining for now a couple of days in a row, which never happens in Malta, so no tennis for me, and we don't have many indoor courts here, so it's a little bit of a dilemma for a true tennis nerd when it's raining that much. I know in other parts of the world this might be normal, but in Malta it's pretty much sunny, you know, 300 plus days a year, so this is a little bit unusual to have this kind of long rain period in October. Yeah, very strange, but hopefully next week back to tennis, back to testing and more videos. Today I wanted to talk about string tension and pro player string tensions, and the reason for this video is that a guy called Amar, he put up a tension sheet from the Vienna Open. I know some players aren't happy to have their string tension revealed. I don't think it's a big deal. I don't understand what difference that makes if people know what rackets or strings they use. I don't think they have any real advantage in that. It's all what they do with the equipment they have, in my opinion. Maybe there's something in that argument I don't understand fully, but I think it's a bit silly that everything should be secret. So I think we can learn something from this tension sheet, and I think it's great that Amar could share it with us. And let's dive into it. Let's have a look, see what we can figure out based on what's in this sheet. And it's from a computer, probably from the string room, and we can first start to decipher what's in this sheet. As you can see, this is not rocket science. If you're a German speaker, you completely understand straight away. For non-German speakers, I can just give you the kind of brief translation of how to read this sheet. So the name, or the Name, that's obviously the name of the player, Vorname und Name. Then you have the Schläger, which is the brand of the racket. Doesn't say exactly what racket model they use. Luckily, since I'm a crazy nerd, I know most of these players' rackets, or pretty much what it is. The Schläger number is the number of that actual racket. So they might have 12 rackets, they might have 6 rackets, and this is racket number 12 or 6 or 3. Datum is date, it's the same in Swedish actually. Längsseite is the string, so and that is the main string. Längsseite is the main string, Querseite is the cross string, and Härte is the tension. DT is the dynamic tension that you can measure with an ERT device. Sadly, these devices, I've talked about them in my tennis tools video a while back. You can't find them anymore. I found one used. I was lucky. I was looking for that for a long time. So they do give you a dynamic tension measurement, which is a pretty accurate way of giving you the overall tension in the string bed. And then you have this kind of small wheel that you can see, you know, what does this reference, this dynamic tension number, how does that relate to the head size, and what kind of tension do you actually have? Some pros are really specific on the DT number. Stringers need to be quite good at getting a high DT. You need to have a really high quality string job generally to get the same dynamic tension over and over. So that's an important figure here that many pro stringers use. I also have one that I measure my string jobs with, although I'm far from a pro stringer, but I'm trying to get a bit better overall. We have obviously some interesting names here, and if we can just start looking at the list. Dan Evans was one of the surprising tensions here, I think. I mean, as you might know, if you've been watching my videos, if you're you know, reading tennisnerd.net and so on, you know that Dan Evans is using an old 6195, likely the Encode 6195, 1820 pattern. He strings it with Alu Power Rough and Wilson Natural Gut. So nothing strange there. The hybrid setup with a different main and a different cross string, that's very common. Fed uses it, Novak uses it, Murray, as you can see in this list, also uses it. Quite a popular way to get a little bit of a softer, you know, string bed, a little bit more power from the natural gut. So it's just a nice feeling, because they want that gut feel but want more durability and more spin from the poly in this case. So then Evans, he strings his rackets both with the rough in the mains and the gut in the crosses at 48 pounds. And for me, that's a very low tension for a natural gut hybrid. It's just quite low. I'm a bit surprised to see this. If you're talking kilos, this is Let's see, 49 pounds is 22 kilos, so this is actually 21.5 kilos. And that's a low tension for an actual gut and a poly hybrid. But yeah, it works for him. I mean, he uses a lot of topspin, quite an extreme grip, and for such a small head size racket, so probably he gets the control from the racket, and then he likes to string it low. And to add to this whole thing is that, you know, they're playing indoors. This is in Vienna. It's an indoor tournament. I've been there. Fast playing courts. Nice tournament to go to, actually, I must say. A nice city as well, Vienna. They know the conditions here, so they know that there's no weather to think about. There's not humidity to think about. There's not, you know, if it's gonna be very cold or very hot that day. They don't have to worry about that, so they can, you know, go in and don't need to change up so many different tensions. If you're playing with very varying conditions, you need more variance in the tension. So you might need a higher tension for hot and humid days where the balls are a bit more lively and jumping a bit faster, or you need to lower your tensions for colder days where everything is a bit dead. You need to generate a bit more power. The string bed feels a bit stiffer because of the cold. So here you have controlled conditions, you're playing indoors. Probably they don't need to string up so many tensions. Maybe they have two, three different ones in case they want more control, or they just have one in some cases where they just go for a fresher frame once they start feeling that they lose some control. This one is a bit more controlled. Usually you see a bit of higher tensions indoors, so a 48 pounds for Dan Evans is a bit surprising to me. Casper Ruud, on the other hand, I mean, with his Yonex extended 100 square inch E-zone, it's not a surprise at all with his poly hybrid that he strings it pretty high. He hits a big ball, he has a very powerful racket. So I'm not at all shocked to see that he's playing with such a setup. One guy that stands out here, and that stands out in general now in the ATP Tour calendar, is Jannik Sinner. He's playing really well, won four tournaments this year, and yeah, he keeps fulfilling his potential, which is pretty impressive. And he strings his head speed. It's an older speed, the speed touch that he customizes. He strings it with Head Hawk, which is a pretty stiff poly, a controlled poly, and he strings it at 28 kilos. I think that's around 60 pounds ish, and that's a high tension for a poly setup. So if you look at Novak, for example, uses a 95 square inch racket, plays with an Alu Power and Natural Gut Hybrid. He strings around the same tension, but that makes sense if you're using kind of natural gut in the string bed as well. You can go for a higher tension than for a hybrid, but for a poly, that's quite rare today. You're seeing mostly lower tensions. That's the overall trend. So you can definitely tell that Jannik Sinner can generate a lot of pace on his shots if he needs this kind of 28 kilo string tension. So that's an interesting figure in this lineup. And to compare him, you can go for Lloyd Harris, who plays with a Yonex DR98. He uses Politour Pro 1.20 gauge, and he strings it at 44 pounds. That's a much lower tension. That's really low tension, like 20 kilos. That's definitely requires some good timing and topspin on the ball to be able to control it, especially indoors. So that's a really big contrast to Jannik Sinner. It's a big difference in their tension. The Harris racket is a little bit more controlled, you can argue, but not that much. So interesting. Maybe he doesn't customize it that much. Usually when you have a lighter racket, you go for a lower tension. That's something I see. If you have a heavy racket, that means you're gonna get more power, has a higher swing weight, so you're gonna get more power, then you need to bump up the tension a little bit. That's overall what I see. If they're playing with a pretty light racket, they need a little bit of a lower tension, maybe a little bit more wristy technique. You can look at Adrian Mannarino, for example, who is one of the guys that strings 35 pounds or something. He's very, very low tension and uses a lot of wrist in his shots. Maybe not the best to teach towards juniors, but it works for him. We can also look at the kind of brand loyalty of these players. If we look at some of these players, they stick within the brand. Usually, obviously the brand wants them to use their strings, their clothes if they can, but it's always depends on what's in the contract, of course. You see some brand loyalty. The bubble up players like Alcaraz and Fognini, they're pretty loyal to RPM Blast. Most bubble up players seem to use RPM Blast. Dominic Thiem not, but otherwise it's pretty common. And you have guys like Matteo Berrettini, for example, uses Signum Pro Firestorm for his head pro stock, head extreme pro stock. Many head pro players, they like to use Head Hawk. That's pretty popular string and a good string for your control. And you can also add like a natural gut hybrid, and like Zverev, for example, with the Head Hawk and the VS Touch, the natural gut from Babolat. Most Wilson players seem to use Lux Lon strings, obviously. Natural gut and Lux Lon, that's a very common setup. But some head players here, if you look at the list, also use Solinco strings. If you look at players like, for example, Dominic Kupfer and Peter Gvojcik, they use Solinco strings. You also have Hubert Hurkacz, who is Yonex sponsored players, uses Yonex apparel, plays with Vicor Pro 97 330 gram from some years back, and he uses Solinco strings and Babolat VS Touch as well. So quite interesting to see players kind of straying a little bit outside their typical, you know, brand for strings. For example, most Yonex players seem to use Yonex strings. Most Babolat players seem to use Babolat strings. Not sure if they're stricter on the contracts. While head players use a little bit of everything, sometimes head strings, sometimes other string brands. Wilson players seems to stay with Lux Lon. It's not a knock on head strings. I think Head has the most sponsored players out there, perhaps alongside Wilson. Tennis pros are usually so specific that even if a brand comes in and says, "Hey, this and this in the contract," but they don't want to change their setup. So if they like a string, they don't want to change it, even if they can get a very, very similar string from their new sponsor. It's quite a drastic change for a pro player to change anything in their setup, really, the racket, the string, the shoe, and whatnot. So they want to stay within what works for them. That's why I get very surprised when I see players who, for example, win a Grand Slam like Iga Świątek and then moves over to a Technifiber frame. Doesn't seem to have hurt her game that much going from the Prince to the Technifiber, but it's always surprising when a player does a change after a positive result. Naomi Osaka, she quit with her coach when she won a Grand Slam. Same happened with Emma Raducanu. And then you found Iga Świątek changed her racket as soon as she won a Grand Slam. It just seems a little bit counterintuitive, but you know, the players usually understand what's best for them, or sometimes they make mistakes, whatever. But I always find it interesting when a player changes something up, tries something new. We had a period when Dominic Thiem, he used several different string setups, were testing like Babolat RPM Power, and then he was testing some head strings in his Babolat that was top secret stuff because he was sponsored by Babolat. There's a lot of secrets around pro player gear, which I think, relating back to how I started this, is a little bit silly, and I don't think necessary. I think it should be pretty common knowledge, and that's fine. I mean, if they're testing new strings or whatnot, but obviously these companies put in a lot of money into this, and they want to make sure that their brand is protected and that they get the best possible marketing opportunity. I understand that part of it as well, but string tensions for me is not the biggest thing. It's more maybe that they don't want players to understand that some of their pros are using other string brands. It's not a knock on their strings, it's just that this pro is liking this setup for whatever reason. I think that's just how life goes and how tennis is. I mean, if you find a string you like, then don't matter what brand it is, you know, you just have to get a setup that you play well with, for example. Okay, I hope you found something useful from this. Interesting around tensions, higher tensions from Fognini and Sinner, that's pretty obvious, and lower tensions from Harris, for example. I think there was Marcelo Melo uses a really low tension RPM and VS gut, 18 kilos. That's very low. The doubles players overall seem to use lower tensions from what I can see. Not sure why that is. I thought they would actually use higher tensions based on that the pace and the reactions and stuff should be, you know, more intense in doubles, but maybe I'm mistaken there. And I don't see the reasoning. But if you have an idea why the doubles players in this tournament at least are using lower tensions overall, even Rajiv Ram, their VS Alu, it's 51, 48 pounds, pretty low tension. Seems like tensions are dropping also in hybrids. That's pretty clear. I think the main learning from all this is that you need to play with what works for you. The pros do that. There's no real patterns. It just is what works for that player. You can see some logic in all this, like a guy that hits big with a 100 square inch racket needs a higher tension, like Jannik Sinner and Fabio Fognini, makes all the sense in the world. For some reason, doubles players seem to use lower tensions. A guy that uses a very controlled racket, like Dan Evans, a 95 square inch, uses a a low tension. That maybe makes a lot of sense. Lloyd Harris, not sure why he's using such a low tension, how that works for him. He looks like he hits a bigger ball, but maybe he hits with enough spin or just works for him somehow. So you need to play with what works for you. That's the main takeout, as always, from my videos. And we need to find whatever that is, and that is a kind of a good mix for our game, whether it's the racket, the string, the shoe, whatever. So that's the quest, and that's the fun part about it. You don't need to copy pros. You need to learn from pros sometimes, maybe, but then take that and use that for your own game and your own gear. I hope you found this video useful, and thanks to Amar for posting these tensions. I find it always really interesting when I see some pro player info, so just lets me nerd out a bit. And thanks for watching. If you want to support Tennis Nerd, join patreon.com/tennisnerd. And if you want to buy something tennis related, check out my affiliates in the description below. There's also Swing Vision, Top Court, other good partners that I have there that you can sign up to when I get a small commission. Thanks, have a nice day, and don't forget to play some tennis.